Bye.
Hi, everyone, and welcome to the fourth season of Parent Talk, where we strive to parent authentically and grow alongside our children. I'm your host, Genevieve Kyle, mom of two. We're proud to broadcast out of the Vancouver area and are proud to provide the most up-to-date expert information for today's parent. Our goal is to inspire you, become a more confident, peaceful, connected, and of course, authentic parent. I'm with my co-host, Heather Fox. Hi, Heather.
Hi, everyone. Yes, Heather Fox here, co-host of Parent Talk. I am also a mom of two, and we all know parenting can be a journey that we shouldn't be doing alone. So we want to be the best parent we can be, and that means, of course, listening, learning, and sometimes asking for help, and that's not a bad thing. Our community is here to bring you strength and support along the way from pregnancy to puberty and beyond.
Yes, well, thank you, Heather. Welcome. So today we're talking about music therapy, and we are happy to have with us Brian Deo. And Brian is a music therapist with over 20 years of experience working extensively with geriatric and children with special need. He currently has his own practice working with autistic children and adults. So hi, Brian. Welcome to Parent Talk Podcast.
Thank you very much for having me, Genevieve and Heather. It's a real pleasure to be here. And I'm just happy to be able to talk about this today.
Yeah, well, it's fantastic to have you. Music therapy, it's something I think maybe we all a little bit know about, but nobody really know what is it all about. So can you tell us a little bit about music therapy?
Yeah, I get asked that question all the time. It's one of those things. It's been around for quite a while. I mean, in relative terms, it's a very young profession. I mean, we look at psychology today, that's considered a young profession, and that's been around for like 100 and some odd years, really. But music therapy, the actual programming and the actual implementation of it has been, the program has actually been started since around the early 70s here in the West Coast, but it goes back a little bit further than that. But music therapy, essentially, there's a couple ways to explain it, I guess. Like if I were to read the definition, one of the definitions I have is on my website, and basically it says music therapy is a profession which uses music as a therapeutic tool for health and healing. Certified music therapists, also known as MTAs, use a variety of methods and approaches in working with people on physical, psychological, spiritual, behavioral, and or social development. But in a nutshell, basically it's using music as an alternative way to get through to people. And the best way I describe it is that we all probably experience music therapy in different forms every day. And the most profound way I think you find it is that music, it can be a very strong bookmark for your memories. So we have great memories, happy memories, and also very sad and sometimes terrible memories that can be tied with music. And, you know, you think about your first song for your wedding, or maybe at your grad, you might remember your high school dance that you danced to, or you kissed your first boy or girl, or, you know, really fun events. And then also you remember, you know, music and songs from really sad events, that's, you know, a loved one's funeral, or, you know, something terrible that did happen. And music is one of those things that can really tie in with events that are really, that mean a lot to us, whether they be happy or sad. So I think in a nutshell, that's a really good way to describe music therapy in terms of that connection. It's definitely, you know, memories is one of those things. But then using music as a therapeutic tool, that's a bit different, you know, because not all of us are good with talk therapy. If somebody says, well, how you feeling? How you doing? I hear you're sad. What's going on? Not everybody is going to be able to do that and be able to talk about it. But all of a sudden you have some music. Maybe it's a drum or maybe it's a keyboard. And it's a different part of your body. You're not using this part to talk, but you're maybe using these to talk, you know, or you're using your hand with the stick to talk, or strumming a guitar, and then maybe not using your voice as speaking, but as in singing. So that is music therapy. And the job that I have is I take all those different modalities and I find a way to apply them with specific people in a way that's going to get them a response, where maybe talking might not do that. I have a really good colleague, a good friend of mine. She's a great music therapist out in Calgary, very popular out there. And her motto is, music speaks when words cannot. And to me, that's really profound. And I found that that sort of sticks with me sort of in my practice with what I do, is that it really does make a big difference there. So that in a nutshell is what music therapy is. So I can go on all night.
I love it. Yeah.
Awesome. So what can you tell us some different examples of what you do as a music therapist and who you treat?
Yeah, absolutely. You know, sort of to connect with what I was talking about before, let's say I'm working with geriatrics and Alzheimer's. So, you know, we're working with like, you know, grandmas and grandpas, people between like the, let's say late 60s, 70s, all the way through to the 100 pluses. And, you know, with that later age bracket, there's a lot of different health issues that do come out. And one of the number one things is something called dementia, where, you know, where mom or dad or grandma or grandpa start sort of losing their memory about certain things. And what happens is maybe there might be a regression where they might lose faculties of being able to, you know, talk as well, or, and they can't live at home anymore and have to be put into a extended care facility or a home. And so you have lots of different things that are happening to them where, you know, besides the memory loss, there's this feeling of isolation and feeling like the world may be slowly getting smaller around it. And what music therapy can do, what I can do in there is I can bring my guitar, bring some music in and sort of help expand the world again for them using the music. And it's not going to be like the top 40 from today, but it's going to be the top 40 of their time. If you think back, like probably the most effective time or the most profound time, I'm using that word a lot, but the time where the music really hits you is, I'd say, between adolescence and probably your 30s. So in that bracket of time, you know, you're really going to say, oh yeah, I really remember those songs. Or as the kids say, I really vibed with those songs, you know, that they were, you know, they're really cool. And so, you know, for me, I'm an 80s kid. So, you know, all the songs from the 80s and even the 90s, you know, those times where they, you know, really, really reverberate with me. So you go to geriatrics, that timeline is going to be like the 40s and 50s, you know, 30s, 40s, 50s. So I take a lot of that music and I perform it live with them. And what that does, it elicits memories and it gets the brain really firing. And what happens is you have someone who might be looking reserved, maybe withdrawn, maybe not socializing with other residents or the staff, or even having a hard time with the family. And the music can bring them back to life. It all of a sudden, these memories start going again. And I can't tell you how many, you know, kids, grandkids, families who've come in after their parent has had a music therapy session, and they actually feel like, I can't believe it. I'm talking to mom and she's actually answering my questions. And she was talking about this song that she heard when she was young. And, you know, for a family, the hardest thing is to see your mom and dad sort of decline. And you remember them for the person that they were. And now you see them for who they are right now. And it's so hard to see that difference. And what music can do is it can sort of bring that back, whether it be for, you know, a few hours, but the effect actually does last a fair amount after a session. And what you have then is it's like what we call creating normalcy. And, you know, what is normal these days? I don't know. But, you know, in terms of being able to have a conversation with somebody whereas you couldn't, you know, so there's no drugs involved. It's just music, it's stimulation, it's conversation. And it's just been done in such a way where they're having a good time and they didn't even know they were doing work, but they were. So
interesting.
That's what I do with the geriatrics with Alzheimer's, with kids with autism, and with special needs kids. I worked almost 20 years in the North Vancouver School Board. And what I did there was I used music in small groups and used music as more of an organizer, an educational tool, being able to teach, to take turns, to learn how to socialize, increase attention span, all these goals and objectives that we have. I mean, we usually go in there with an ulterior motive. We have a plan of what we're going to do. We have goals and objectives. We're going to get Jimmy to really work on making eye contact with people today and being able to wait his turn. And if maybe Jim has a speech impediment or a very quiet voice. We're going to get him to work on getting his volume today. And how are we going to do that? We're going to do songs maybe about lions roaring and hitting big drums. So really getting the body moving, getting everything moving and to elicit, you know, more. And that's, you know, if I said, okay, Jimmy, you're going to sit down and hit this drum and you're going to yell really loud. And you're like, what? But if you make it fun, let's be dinosaurs and let's roar and let's stomp and ah, you know, kids love that. Right. And also being able to give them choices, you know, do you want this tambourine or do you want this drum? Your choice. You know, how often do kids get a choice these days? It's, you know, a lot, you know, do you want the iPad or do you want the fruit snacks, you know? You know, it's about choices, you know, trying to empower kids with choices and also at the same time being able to take that platform and be able to be an enforcer as well. So, you know, you need to listen. If you can't listen, then you won't get a chance to play the drum or you won't get a chance to try the didgeridoo or, you know, whatever great instrument that is out there. In this day and age of laptops, computers, iPads, PS4s, PS5s now, you know, all these different things that kids can play and doodle with, there's still a huge attraction to shiny instruments that make different sounds that you can hold and twist that have weight to them. You know, we live in a really virtual world right now. So more than ever, there's nothing more important than giving kids something that sort of feels in their hand, like has weight to it, because it's all by pushing buttons or clicking a mouse or swiping a screen. And those movements are great. They're very important. They're part of developmental. It's part of the education now, but there's still nothing like holding a pair of sticks in your hand, hitting a drum or getting your hand onto a drum or onto a keyboard or trying an instrument from another world that you didn't, or another part of the world that you didn't know existed. So, you know, that's a very strong message that's out there. So education through music in a way that's fun and it's not, doesn't feel like education. I'm not going to say, well, this is the didgeridoo. We're going to sit down. We're going to talk about its origins. We're going to say, no, it's the didgeridoo. Do you know where it's from? You don't. Oh, okay. Well, for next time, why don't you go and tell me? Go find out. Go with your teacher. Go with your learning assistant. Find out and come back to me. So it's a different way of making something fun, but also we're definitely covering a lot of goals and objectives. So that's sort of in a nutshell what music therapists do. There's so many other applications, you know, not just with the elderly and kids, but also with neurotypical people, like people who just people like you and me, who want a different way of talking or expressing themselves. And so it could be through music, trying an instrument, just using the instrument as a bridge to be able to talk about things, or even songwriting. And there's a lot of great programs out there for songwriting, also vocal psychotherapy, and you know, lots of different modalities that music therapists, colleagues of mine, really employ in amazing ways to help people, you know, on all spectrums.
Well, it absolutely sounds beautiful. I love the education part of it as well, to get the kids to be curious about the instrument and go find out about it. But my question is, so when you cannot be one-on-one and with social distancing right now and this COVID time, is it possible to actually call you and have a session with you?
You know, I actually haven't done actually online sessions with people, but you know, I mean, it would take some doing, but there are some ways, there would be some ways to do it. It would definitely would take some help on both ends. If it's more of a music session, that's the way we classify things is if we're working with somebody who's higher functioning and they can actually play instruments or understand instructions, you know, higher, you know, multiple step instructions, then that's a little easier. But if you're working with somebody who's a little lower functioning, who needs a lot of hand-to-hand help, then the logistics get really hard, because, you know, that whole point of music therapy as well is being able to be close sometimes. You know, sometimes somebody just needs to have, you know, a hand over their hand touch, just mm-hmm. to be with somebody, to experience that, you know, that feeling of being with somebody else other than, you know, a caregiver, but who's still giving him a safe place. I mean, and that's the one thing I forgot to touch on is like the most important thing for me when I lecture, because I do lecture the third years up at Cap University about music therapy with children. But it doesn't really matter if it's with kids, it's with whoever you are. The most important thing is to create a safe container, a safe place for them to feel. So that's why when they come to our office, they see the instruments, they see it's a place that they can be. They close the door to the office, mom or dad are sitting outside, or they're going to get a coffee while they're doing their work in our place. It's their place, just as much as my place is their place. And so their place to work, their place to play, but their place to also grow and have these experiences. Maybe experiences you're not going to have in your house because it's somewhere else. And it should be, it should feel special. So, back to your question about online, it is possible, but it's limited right now, I'd say. In terms of doing online with group homes to, group extended care facilities with Alzheimer's, geriatrics, all that, I am doing that actively right now. And we try to still, the facility still has to adhere to their social distancing rules, so they can only have 10 people to a group. Then, I try to work it out and say, okay, you got me for an hour. So let's do a half hour, 10 people, and then get 10 more people in. And if that works, so is it more work for the staff? Yes, it probably is, for sure. But, what is the alternative? That they don't have that programming? So the staff see the value in it and they don't mind doing it. And, I get nothing but support from the people who I'm working with. So, and yeah. It's great for them because, Zoom doesn't just have to be looking in a screen. If I have a camera and I can see where people are, I can see what the layout of the building is. I can actually say, oh, well, let's look out your window, and I can pretend. Oh, it's raining over there. Part of what I do, it's every music therapist is different. I'm a bit of a ham. I like performing, but I also really like to try to extend that fourth wall to get people involved. And that's part of it. The social aspect of it, whether it's a child or an adult, is you want to get them involved. You really want to look at them and talk to them, and use the music as a part of that. So yeah, Zoom definitely has more capabilities than we think it is. I mean, it's great for just meetings, but you actually can, find ways to entertain people. And if I could see the person, I could say, oh, Heather, how are you doing today? And then you get a response from that. Oh, Genevieve, I love that shirt. You're looking great. Keep going. What are we going to do next today? And just that further interaction, it doesn't just have to be one way. So that's yes, there are limitations to Zoom, but it doesn't have to be, it doesn't have to be like, all or nothing either. So
I'm happy to hear that it's doable. Yeah. I mean, it's case to case, person to person, right?
Absolutely.
So I'm curious, Brian, what kind of qualification music therapists have?
Yeah, good question. Basically, all MTAs or certified music therapists who are working have to have gone through a program either locally here or abroad. There's five institutions you can probably go right now. I have a list of them here. The one closest here right now is in North Vancouver, actually. You're very lucky if you want to become a music therapist and you're qualified and you can pass the auditions and all those things. You can go to Capilano University. They're also in Manitoba. They have the Canadian Mennonite University. That's in Winnipeg, Manitoba. And in Nova Scotia, in Acadia, they have Acadia University. And that is specifically for the program that's called the BMT or the Bachelor's in Music Therapy program. And so you can go there and get your bachelor's in music therapy. And then they do actually, believe it or not, they do have master's programs as well. And so if you want to pursue to get your master's, you can go to Wilfrid Laurier University in Ontario or Concordia. And that will give you qualifications for a bachelor's. And then if you like to go to get your master's, most people go get their master's there. And the University of Toronto actually has a PhD program for music therapy as well. And for those people who just want to actually start, besides, just get the foundations before they try it out for a music therapy program, because it's a two-year program to actually get your bachelor's, but you need your 2 years of prerequisites. So it's a four-year in total program. But besides getting your prerequisites or the foundations at Capilano U or these other places, Douglas College offers pre-classes, or what they call music therapy foundations, which is a two-year program, which gives basic your basic skill sets that you need to have before you actually can audition or apply to get to the music therapy programs of aforementioned places there. So so you have to get your four. I did my 4 years. I did my at Capilano University. And then on top of that, you have to do 1,000 hours of internship. And you don't get paid for that. So yeah, that's a lot of work. You know, some people grunt through it and get it done in 6 months. Some people work part-time and, you know, and do it in 9 months or a year. I decided to work part-time myself and just try to get my hours. And so, you know, somehow pay rent and still, you know, get out there and get the experience. Looking back at it now, it was super, super valuable because I got a chance to work with other music therapists who were like my mentors, and because of them, I was able to get jobs later on. So, you know, there's a lot of passing of torches that happens at places where, I actually was, you know, had the pleasure of passing the torch of my North Van school board to, two of my interns who worked with me, and you know, I got a chance to see them, and now they're doing great, which is great. You know, that's what this job's about. You work, but it's like anything, you move on to other things or something else materializes. And, you know, if you can have somebody else or another colleague that you can recommend, then that's great. You know, we're a small community, but we really try to cover each other's backs and make sure that happens. But getting back to this, once you get your 1,000 hours of internship, then you will become what's called an MTA or certified music therapist. And then like dentists or doctors or physios or OTs, you have to be associated with your proper association. So you have to sign on with Canadian Association of Music Therapy and MTABC, Music Therapy Association of BC. And you have to be in good standing with them before you can, so you can continue to practice. So there's checks and balances, just like any organized profession, and that's working in healthcare. You need to have those requirements, and you know, if you don't, you ethically you really should get them. And you know, it's for the safety of our clients as well, and our profession, that we need to have that. So those are the base requirements, qualifications that you need to have, and then experience helps as well. You know,
well,
so
I feel good to hear all about it. 1,000 hours is quite a bit of hours after, but I guess, you know, I mean, you got to be on the field, right?
Yeah, exactly. I mean, yeah. And I think, you know, anybody who does like in healthcare or, you know, working with the people, you know, experience is key. So, you know, even, you know, after I did my 1,000 hours and I got out there and started working, there was still so much I just didn't know. And, you know, now, even though I say, you know, just when I think I've seen everything, oh man, something else happens. And like, oh my God, you know, I did not expect that to happen. Or like, did that really happen? Or wow. You know, so people people continue to astound and amaze me. And there are days where my job really doesn't feel like a job. I just think it's, you know, after 20 years, it just feels amazing. But then there are other days where you come home and you just need to be scraped up off the floor with a little knife and like, you know, just sort of stuck on the couch and like, you know, it's horrible. Why am I doing this? But, you know, that's life. And that's what the job is about. So, but you know, no regrets. I love what I do. And, you know, I love working with the people that I work with and, you know, experiencing new things. So it's a good thing.
That's mm-hmm. awesome. Yeah. So if we want to have music therapy, so do we need to know how to play music to do or to receive music therapy?
Yeah, you actually have to be like a classically trained musician. No.
I was going to say, can I get my guitar out of the closet and start playing and just.
Sure you can. See, the whole idea is like, you know, this is a really good question because, you know, we think, especially in this day and age, there's so much music out there. It's super produced and it's auto-tuned and everything sounds perfect. But even if we go back to like a few hundred years, you go back to classical music and you go back to classical playing and concerts, the whole idea was that it's this perfect piece played. It sounds beautiful and it's perfect and that's how it should be. And so it's very product oriented. And with music therapy, it's not about the product. It's about the process of making it. And so, you know, it'd be like, you know, if you're in a pottery class and you have somebody making these beautiful, beautiful pots and these, you know, vases and they look beautiful and then you want to do it. you know, and it turns out, and you're mad because it looks ugly to you. But the question is, you know, why did you go there? Did you go there to make the beautiful things, or does it just feel good to have the mud in your hands? You know, and that's music is a lot. It's a lot like that. It's, you know, taking something maybe that you might not be doing all the time or maybe never done before, but you're experiencing it and you're making something. And whether it's just hitting a note on a piano, that's still making music, or you hit a drum once, that's making music. And, you know, saying one word to a lyric, that's making music. So it starts like Lego. You start with one block and then you start building from there. And whether you like it or not, it doesn't matter, because you can do it again and you can change it. And music is one of those things that it comes and then it goes, but you can come back and try to make it, but it might be different. It might be the same, you know, that's the neat thing about music. And so you don't need to know how to play. I mean, some of the best music that I've made, or some of the best things that have happened with people, is when they don't know how to play, when they haven't had experience. And you just see the instinct come out and musicality that they didn't even know they had. It comes out and you say, wow, that's amazing. You know, if anything from just playing or improvising something to actually making song lyrics, and they go, damn, I didn't know I could do that. But I said that, I wrote that. I love having clients where I pull out something from maybe a month ago or something, and I say, yeah, I got this song to show you. Yeah, I was listening to it the other day. And I just play a bar. They go, oh, that's really cool. I go, yeah, you wrote that. I did? They go, yeah, that's you. You did that. I go, wow, I didn't know I could do that. I didn't know I had that in me. So, you know, self-expression is definitely one of the key things for music therapy. But once again, if I said, Genevieve, you're going to sit down and you're going to sing a song, we're going to write a song right now. You're like, oh my God, you know, what am I going to, you know, what, you know, but we do it in a different way. We take a different approach where we talk about, you know, we talk about a couple things, and then I say, well, hey, I had this idea, and I play a couple notes, and you say, yeah, what does that make you think of? And, oh, it's a word. And then you start from there. And next thing you know, you start this creative process. It's a lot different than saying, you're going to write me a song, you know? So because, oh, that you're going to make me a product, you know? No, we're going to have a process and then we're going to see what happens. And that's where we build from there. And that's one of the basis is the basis. That's the basis of building, you know, a foundation of trust, you know, through music, and not saying, you know, you must trust me. It's not that. It's just the music. You trust the music. And then all of a sudden, you know, the other bridge starts getting built as well. So that's the beauty of music therapy, is that you don't.
I love it. I want to write my own song. I'm listening to you. I'm like, I think I'm going to go for music therapy because I want to write my own songs. And yeah. I have no idea how to do it.
Yeah. The creative process is one of those things that you don't even think about, right? You know, oh, I can never do this. I can never be a songwriter. I can never make music, you know, but yeah, you can, you know, it's easier than ever now, you know, with all the stuff that's out there. But sometimes just having one person just to sort of take you down the basic road to go, then.
Well, I can see how children, it would light them up and it will get them to be like, what? I did this. And then, like you say, if you play with the little ones, now we are like, I don't know, you probably sometimes do like the big dinosaur coming boom, 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 and the little mouse with the little ting, ting, ting. And then you can make a story with this and actually let them grow into the story and having so much fun, right? It's probably something you do.
That is absolutely something I do. I actually have something called a story drum, which is just a drum. But, you know, once you say it's a story drum, then it's special. Yeah. Oh, it's a story drum. Yeah. No, it's a tambourine. No, it's a story drum. Okay. Yeah. So, you know, but we take turns. We hit the story drum. We can start telling a part of the story. You hit the drum again, you stop. And then you pass it to the next person. They got to hit the drum and continue the story. You know, that's a variation of it. Or yes, you can use it for sound effects. You have like a big drum for like something big, little instruments for something small. Voices as well, you know, high voices, low voices, you know, all these different things that you can make just with the, you know, these instruments that we have, you know, besides drums and pianos and things, you know, we have all these wonderful instruments, you know, here and here, and you know, we forget to use them. And so definitely. We do that. We create different stories, plays, role playing. And once again, what that does is it brings them closer. It brings common themes together. And, you know, that's a good basis of group dynamics as well, where all of a sudden, where you don't have to think about what the common theme is for somebody. Oh, you got brown hair, I got brown hair. Or, oh, he likes Pokemon, I like Pokemon. No, we play this music and they play the drum that way, I played it that way. But we didn't even talk about it. It just happened, you know? So it's the verbal and the nonverbal things that happen, you know, those connections that get made. And a really important part of socializing, right, is the verbal and the nonverbal things that happen between people, you know, just from a look to, you know, a nod, to a smile, you know, all those things, they make a big difference. And, you know, if we can translate from some of those things from what we do in music group to a classroom or even to the family setting, what you have then is that you have a better balanced child who might understand social cues better, you know? So those are the big words coming out from goals and objectives, you know? And so it's taking the language of making good music in this and then translating it into something that has value to, let's say, psychologists, doctors, the empirical value, because they want to know, like, is it measurable? What's happening? Is verbalization increasing, you know? You know, I don't know. Let's ask Jimmy, is your verbalization increasing? No, he can't tell you, you know, because he's five. So, you know, he's busy watching Flintstones, you know. So, so definitely it's being able to take the work that we do and make it valid to the professional side of things as well, because we are part of a team. Yeah, when I first started up doing music therapy, it was really hard because a lot of the Western medicine, a lot of the empirical, the doctors didn't really see it. They didn't take us as serious, you know, because we just were like these dudes and gals playing guitars and, you know, that's kind of, oh, you know, what's that? But when you start speaking the language and all of a sudden you're writing in the charts and they're noticing the differences and you're able to explain yourself in their language, they take it a lot more seriously. Oh, I see. Okay. So it's being able to take the intangibles of the music, but make them tangible as well. And that's, you know, that's what the qualifications for, that's what going to school is for, is being able to understand that you have to be able to speak the jargon. It's not just music. It's actually a lot of psychology. I mean, intro psych, mm-hmm. Psych of aging, developmental psych, abnormal psych, group dynamics, stats. So it's pretty psych heavy. People don't realize that when they say, oh, it's music, you just play guitar. Yeah, you know, that's, you know, for a long time.
That's a part of it, you know, but.
It is, you know. So there are some colleagues of mine who have a real problem. They say, you know, I'm a music therapist. You know, I'm out there and this is what I do. And if somebody says, are you the entertainer to me? I said, yeah, I'm the entertainer. That's fine. I don't mind. You know, are you the guitar guy? Yes, I am the guitar guy. You know, because really, at the end of the day, you know, I know what I'm doing for my job. And if it means that, you know, they're going to be able to talk to their mom or dad, or that, you know, I've made just a little bit in half an hour, I've made a bit of difference for a child that they can go home and maybe be able to communicate better with their parents, then I'm doing my job. And, you know, mm-hmm. I don't need to explain it to them unless they want me to, you know, and then I'll sit down with them. And if they really want me to use, you know, all the jargon and the words, I can. It's kind of boring, but I can, you know, you know, it's possible. Absolutely. So to answer your question, no, you don't need to know how to play music in order to do music therapy and to do really good at it, you know, because it's all subjective, you know. But it's my job to take that and then be able to translate it and say, okay, this is what, you know, Genevieve did great today. We wrote a song today about clouds, but what I did notice is that she's playing the drum and using both hands today, bilateral movement. And she's actually able to play for 35 minutes instead of 30. So, you know, that's where you take the other hat off and you're able to analyze what's going on.
If we think about like ADD, ADHD, attention, you know, is it something that you will actually work with children with that have a problem like paying attention?
Yeah.
On something for a long time or?
Yeah. Basically, I try to address those issues with the children. And it depends really if it's a one-to-one issue versus working in a groups. This is where actually working in groups actually has an advantage. If you're working with kids with ADHD, one-to-one, there's a lot that can happen because they're like, oh, that's this. And oh, what's that? And oh, you know, like, okay, focus, focus, focus. You know, it's so hard. But, you know, if we get them involved in doing an instrument, let's say with multiple drums, that's going to really engage them because there's a lot going on. So, you know, the hardest part is that a lot of people think that ADHD is something that you can just, you know, turn off and on. It's not. I mean, it's always there for them. And it's almost painful sometimes, I think, because part of them really wants to focus, but their brain can't turn the other stuff that's happening off. And so if you get multimodal things happening, it's sort of, it's like things start gathering a little closer. So, you know, on a one-to-one session, that's probably what I would do. But group sessions are great because you can actually be able to get the group to help each other out. So if you have somebody like Johnny's really, really active and say, okay, Johnny, you hit this drum, but he can't right now. I said, okay, somebody help Johnny, your turn, hit the drum. And they, I want to have my turn. Oh, you wait your turn. Are you ready for it now? And then all of a sudden the focus comes in there. I said, no, it's like a bus. If you don't catch it, you'll get the next one, but you don't want to miss this bus, do you? I don't want to miss the bus. You don't want to miss the bus? Sure. Go. And they hit it like, oh yeah. Okay. So then it's that engagement. We live in a day and age, even for me, like we have games have levels. And if you make something that there are levels to, you want to reach the next level. That is super involving. I mean, half the games they play with on your phones or on the iPads, all to do with levels. And even the games you might play, if anybody still plays Candy Crush or Wordscapes or whatever, it's that, you know, you get that ding, 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 you know, you did it. So, you know, we all want that next level. And so when you make music into a game like that with a group, then you will see definite increase in focus. I mean, you won't see 100% focus, but you'll definitely see a decrease in agitation or, you know, lack of focus. You'll see definitely more attention come to the group. And as it progresses over the weeks, you'll probably see a higher percentage of success. And, you know, and that's great, you know, if you can do that. But yeah, definitely deal with a lot of that. A lot of kids these days who are diagnosed on the spectrum who have a lot of things. They might have, you know, on the spectrum with ADHD and OCD, like, wow, you know, lots of different diagnoses happening right now. And it's our job, you know, to be able to trying to find out where one begins, the other ends, how to work with that with an individual or within a group. And you only usually get like half an hour, 45 minutes. In the school board, my sessions were like half an hour. So I get a group of kids for half an hour once a week. And so, you know, you think about that. You think about how many hours are in a day and how many hours were in a week. And out of all those weeks, you get 1 half hour to work with him and make a difference. And so,
yeah, it's quite short.
It is short. Yeah. But I say to the students, look, if you make, you know, you make even one difference over the course of time that you have with him, mm-hmm. You did a good job. You did something that couldn't be done within the education system. So, you know, take that, you know, you're not going to change the world, but you are in one small way and maybe more than one small way. You might have kids that, you know, really, really take to it and it changes the way they do their approach to learning, their approach to processing information. You know, music is a great way for actually learning how people process things. You know, you hold a tambourine up and they look at the tambourine, or you show them how to play the tambourine, or you tell them how to play the tambourine. So are they auditory listeners or are they visual listeners? You know, are visual learners, I should say, you know, or are they both? Is it a combination of auditory, visual, and, you know, tactile? So these are things that can be assessed within like, you know, a first hour session. You get an idea of how somebody, you know, thinks, and all just from playing a drum or playing a xylophone or different instruments. You're like, oh, okay. So that's why when we usually have a new client come in, we usually just do an assessment. And it's usually in the form of just doing music, but you can learn a lot in a really short time.
Hmm.
I hope that answers your question.
Absolutely. Now, I'm just curious, where can we learn more about music therapy if we want to do more? We're curious.
Right.
Where do we go? What do we do?
Yeah, good questions. Best places to go usually are, I think, one of the best sources is the association sites. So like Canadian Association for Music Therapy, or CAMT, basically has a great resource. And, you know, we get links for that later, but it's www.musictherapy.ca. Pretty easy place to go with. And then even our local chapter, our local BC chapter, is mtabc.com, the Music Therapy Association of British Columbia. That's mtabc.com. And then, you know, I also have on our company website, we have resources on not just music, but art therapy, because my wife's an art therapist. So that is another kettle of fish, you know, but a lot of shared.
Yeah, we're going to have her on the show, art therapy. I'm curious about that too. Yes,
for sure. You know, Michelle, yeah, she could, yeah, she could tell. She actually started the company Van Art Expression in 94. And that's when we weren't quite married yet. We were engaged, and we got married in 95. And then I entered the program at Capilano, at the music therapy program. And then, yeah, I graduated in 97 and then started to join the business as a partner. So, you know, Van Art Expression started out with her solely, you know, putting the shingle up as an art therapist and doing art therapy contracts. We used to do everything on site. We'd drive out everywhere, and then eventually, as we started, you know, word of mouth spreads, you know, and if you're good, usually people start talking about you. So I guess people like this, and they kept talking about us. And so about 6 years ago, we converted our garage into a office therapy space. So now we have clients coming to us as well. And the place I'm talking to you from is actually another separate, our old office, which is now sort of like my studio and places where I do Zoom sessions from as well. So
awesome.
Yeah, it's an amazing road we've gone down, and it's really,
you get to
really
help
cool.
A lot of people.
Yeah, you know, I think about that sometimes. You know, I don't think of it like, yes, I'm out saving the world and helping people. You know, I'm having a good time doing it, but you know, just the amazing relationships that I've had with so many people that have sort of that have come and gone through, you know, the extended care facilities, and I've seen kids grow up in the school board, and you know, and also being a father of a 17-year-old son now, you know, seeing our kid grow up, and, you know, seeing him graduate, and see, you know, just I think, you know, being a parent does give a little bit more of a connection. I mean, there's a lot of great music therapists out there who don't have kids, which have great relationships and great techniques and working with the kids. But I think there's that intangible parent thing that if you're a dad, for some reason, kids, they know if you're a dad, you know, they just know.
Feel it, so right?
I think they do, you know, also in the
I
voice.
I think they know, yeah. Children know.
Exactly, yeah. Just that dad, now Tony, you know, like, oh, my dad uses the same voice. Oh, okay, you know, yeah, you know, it's, you know, or just even the look, like, really? Really, you know, you're gonna try that now, like, you know, just and they're like, oh, I know that look, my mom gives me that look, you know. So yeah, definitely that plays a big role. But yeah, those three sites are really good places to go check out. And also we're also in an exciting time right now where the government and a lot of creative arts therapies are coming together to we're on the verge, I think, of creating a college of counseling therapists, in which, you know, art therapists, music therapists, play therapists, we would all actually fall under the category of becoming what's called a counseling therapist. And that's something to be looking on the lookout for. It'd be a great move for our profession, but also like a really great win for just the clients, for the consumers out there, because then they would know that they'd be getting quality counseling or counseling therapy from whoever, because if they have that label, it's regulated, because right now in BC it's not. And so they've been fighting a long time to get that. So it's really important, you know. But you know, your best bet right now is to definitely, you know, do your homework as parents, you know, talk to the people that you want to work with, or, but, you know, potential therapists who are out there, and you know, get your references. And yeah, definitely I'd say do your homework as well. But hopefully that will be a thing of the past once, you know, hopefully, cross our fingers, regulation gets put in. Yeah. But other than that, yeah, I'd say, you know, if you want to find out more about that, you can go to FactBC, which is which is the organization which is spearheading that, which is, it's made of a bunch of different art therapists, music therapists, counseling therapists as well. And they've been fighting this fight for a good 20 years. And, you know, I think we're really close though. So we'll see.
Awesome.
Yeah.
So Brian, we can find you on our panel of expert at parenttalk.ca. So where else can we find you? Give us your website.
Great. I forgot about that. You can go to our website. Yeah. Our company name is Van Art Expression, and it's Van Art Expression, van-artexpression.com. And basically it's got, that's your one-stop shop. You can go check out everything that you can find out about me, about Michelle, a little bit about our family, and also, you know, important links to, you know, to get in touch with us if you have questions, you know, or we have our own company email, which we check all the time. And so if you have questions, you want to ask us, you know, by all means, we also have our phone number there. So if you want to reach our office and leave a message, yeah, please feel free to do so. And just great to be here. And I want to say thank you very much to both of you for inviting me on to be a part of the panel. And I hope everybody's enjoyed it anyways.
Oh, I'm sure. Well, that concludes today's episode. Like Heather and I want to say a big thank you to you, Brian, for taking the time to be here. And of course, bring so much value to us parents, helping us grow and be the best parents we can be, right?
Absolutely.
Knowing always a little bit more and more and more is the key. And I think our podcast is a great platform for this. And we never talked about music therapy, so it's a pleasure to have you on the show.
Great. Thanks so much for having me. It was an honor. And hopefully we're going to talk some more about something else again.
Yes, of course. So for our listeners, if you have a question or you would like to join us on our show as a guest or as an expert, please visit the Contact Us section on our website at parenttalk.ca. Follow us on Instagram, Facebook, and now also on YouTube at Parent Talk TV. Of course, you can always subscribe directly to this podcast on our website at parenttalk.ca. We hope you enjoyed today's episode, and we're inviting you to share it on your social media. So as we all know, parenting can be hard, so it's important to laugh. Keep learning, cherish your village, and be true to yourself. So Parent Talk is a safe space for everyone. Thank you everyone for listening and joining us. Have a great week. Bye.